So you do stand your ground. Sometimes it does try to come back. Not always, but sometimes. I think it was Dr. P.C. Nelson who said, and others maybe have said it also, but the number one way people lose their healing is by a recurrence of the same symptoms. And in the healing move of the 50s, when there was a special move of God, people would receive a healing because of the special move of God, and then before a few days have gone by, they'd lose their healing. Now, more Pentecostals lost their healing than denominational people because of the special move of God, it's different. And I've talked quite a bit on that, but it seems that people still don't understand that. People believe the healing anointing is the same as the anointing to heal. And they went, huh? And so in Pentecostal circles, a lot of Pentecostals, they believe that. Well, God heals, and when he gets ready, the anointing will flow. And you can come into a Pentecostal church and teach on the healing anointing, and they'll hear it in the light of their religious tradition. Or you can teach it in a Baptist church, and they'll hear it in the light of when God gets ready, when it's his will, he'll heal if he wants to. If he wants to. And so you keep teaching. So in the 50s, the healing revival, denominational people would get healed. Old Roberts had some tent meetings, and the people officiating sent out cards after the healing campaign was over. They sent out cards and asked two questions. Did you get healed during the healing campaign? And are you still healed? And what is your religious affiliation? Well, actually, that's three questions, but it's two questions. One question has a two-parter. One question with two parts, did you get healed? Are you still healed? And then the next question is, what's your religious affiliation? And they got 6,000 replies. Did you hear me? How many? 6,000 replies. And so the people that were going over this and cataloging them, and they said, let's put this in two categories. Let's get the denominational people in one category, in one pile, because we asked the question, what's your religious affiliation? And all of the Pentecostals, let's put in another pile, because we asked the question, what's your religious affiliation? And then let's compare, because we asked, did you get healed and are you still healed? And among the denominational, now this is in the healing revival, see, it won't be the same today. Now, some things will be the same because when you take the gospel to the world, like some are doing, I mean, I really appreciate some of the ministers that are traveling and they see evangelistically signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. I mean, thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of people come to the meetings and you have blind eyes open, deaf ears open. I've talked to some of them personally. And one of the questions that I've been asked, Brother Tony, when I go to Africa, when I go to India, when I go to these different places, we have instant healings of miracles. Why don't we have that in America? And they'd ask, do you have any thoughts on that? Well, I believe I do. And I would give them my response. One pastor in Virginia, he wanted to talk to me after one of the services I was conducting in his meetings. He said that he had done quite a bit of evangelistic work and he'd be in another country and have outstanding miracles. But now he's pastoring and in his own church, it doesn't happen. So he asked me, he said, you've been in the healing ministry for a number of years. You have some thoughts on this. And I'll never forget it. Sitting in his kitchen at his table in the kitchen. You know, he had an eating area there in the kitchen, small table where they could have, you know, some meals in the kitchen. He also had a dining room and a dining area, but this is a small table in the kitchen. That's where we were. And we were sitting there after the Sunday morning service, having a discussion before the Sunday evening service that was coming up. And he said, do you have some thoughts on that? He said, why is that? And I said, well, when you go to another country, you're taking the gospel to the people that have never heard it before. and God will respond differently. Now, they need to believe it, but not as much as required because they're just hearing it for the first time. Now, if they don't believe it, that's different. But if they believe it, God responds. That's why you can see some people go into Africa and India and different areas where some of it... Now, they've got churches. I've been to Jamaica quite a bit, not recently. But they had heard the gospel for years and years and years, and yet even in Jamaica, because it's still evangelistic. Some of the most outstanding miracles in my ministry were in Jamaica. And yet I'm working out of the churches, teaching in the Bible school that's there. The largest ministries on the island is who I was involved with. Now, I didn't, because first time I went, I didn't know them. I'm not from Jamaica, but they said, this is just like Oral Roberts to you. I remember one time when I went to the airport, you've got all of this, as they call it, red tape. And in those days, especially in those days, the government was corrupt. And I'm taking in my equipment. And if you want to see your equipment again, you better give them some extra, because they'll they'll tax it, and or whatever they call it. What do they call it? Duty. You'll have to pay duty, custom. And so, because they want to seize it so they can sell it. You're bringing this in to sell it, aren't you? No, I'm in the ministry. This is my equipment, because I took my equipment to Jamaica. And they said, you're bringing this in to sell it. We're going to charge you custom. Well, that's what happened the very first time. The next time, one of the ministers I was working with said, let me meet you at the airport. If I get there, everything will go smooth. He just walks in the place and everybody recognizes him. I didn't know that at first, but they said, well, he's just like Oral Roberts and Billy Graham to you. Everybody on Jamaica, the island of Jamaica, knows him by sight. And that's who I was working with. And he's putting me in all the churches that he can throughout the island. And I'd have outstanding works of God. Miracles. Instant healings and miracles. Outstanding. And so this minister in Virginia was asking me, because he'd had the same experience. See, the gospel is what does it. T.L. Osborne used to say, if you'd be there the same as I'm there, and you'd preach the same message I preach, you'd have the same results. Because the results aren't the man, the results the gospel. The gospel is what does the work. Jesus Christ is who's the healer. Can somebody say amen? Amen. You preach the message, you'll have the same results. T.L. Osborne used to say, I'm not anything special. I'm just preaching the gospel, and people are believing it, and Jesus Christ is confirming it. You'd be there, and you'd... Now, in America, T.L. Osborne didn't understand why he didn't have the same results. I know that. I heard him say that. Reinhard Bonnke didn't understand why he didn't have the same results. And I know that. I heard him say that. And yet, he'd have tremendous miracles in Africa. Amen. So this minister is asking me. And I said, because it's evangelistic. But you won't have the same results there if you go again and again and again, because God, there's a theme throughout the Bible. God wants his people to grow. And in your own church, God expects more. Like that man I talk about sometimes that was in Lodi, California, that said, I've begun to see God's expecting something of me. When he first was prayed for, he was healed instantly through Amy Simple McPherson. But then 10 years later, he moved to Lodi, and another 11, 12 years later, he developed a double hernia. Now 22 years later, he's going back to Los Angeles to be prayed for, and nothing happens. And A.A. Allen prayed for him, and Jack Coe prayed for him, and Oral Roberts prayed for him, and William Branham prayed for him, and Kenneth Hagin prayed for him twice, and he didn't get anything. But under the teaching, he began to see God's expecting something of me, and he began to apply the principles that he heard in the teaching. And then it took 6 months. 3 months before... I mean, Aretta talked about it tries to come back. Well, you'll have to learn to stand your ground. It may take more than 3 hours. It may take more than 3 days. It may take more than 3 weeks. With that man in Lodi with a double hernia, it took 3 months before it even started to change. And then it went down slowly for another 3 months. but he was healed instantly 22 years ago under the ministry of Amy Simple McPherson. So in the healing move, did you get healed? Are you still healed? The denominational people got healed and were still healed. 70% of them got healed and were still healed. You didn't forget the 6,000 cards, did you? The 6,000 replies. 70% of the denominational people got healed and were still healed. And that's in a healing revival. So I told that minister in Virginia that. Similar, I might have referred to that story, but I said it's the same truth. God expects people who have been taught and who know more or who should know more to act on their own faith. So in the healing move of the 50s, those 6,000 replies, well, the denominational people, 70% of them got healed and were still healed. Now let's look at the Pentecostals. Did you get healed? Are you still healed? Only 3% were still healed. They didn't know how to keep it. 3%. Because in Pentecostal circles, we know God can, and when he gets ready, maybe he will, and let's all pray that he'll do it again. They'll sing a song, do it again, do it again, do it again. It's all up to God anyway, and let's pray that he'll do it again. And yet his word has already been spoken. And then the healing anointing is different from the anointing to heal. Gifts of the Spirit will release the anointing to heal, while the word of God will release the anointing to heal. But the healing anointing that's in a minister, because God has set some in the church, that's what Jesus demonstrated when the woman that had the issue of blood touched him and she drew it out. And if you don't know how to draw it out, it won't come out. Because I know by experience, you can't push it in. It has to be drawn out. A gift of the Spirit could operate, and that's still an anointing to heal, but the healing anointing is different from that. The healing anointing is drawn out by the person. And then you have to keep it. Because before you get out the door, symptoms could try to come back. Or you don't even see any physical change, but you believe you have it on the inside. You believe you have it on the inside. You believe you have it on the inside. And it might be days later before it begins to appear on the outside. And that's where you stand your ground and fight the good fight of faith. Yeah. During that time, when the thoughts come and when the circumstances come, you say, I believe God. I don't believe this. And you don't talk about it. You don't act on it. You push any thoughts that are concerning it out of you. You don't touch it. I believe God. And his word is working, his power is working, and the anointing of God is in me doing a work. And you stand your ground. And that's how it works. Can somebody say amen? The number one way, lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. Gifts of the Spirit can operate, and then that'll work. I hear people, and I teach on this a lot, and you've got to teach on a lot, and there's been so much wrong teaching that people don't hear exactly everything you're saying. That's why I encourage people to listen to the message again, because there might be something you missed. I understand some of these things. I don't understand everything. Who does? But I understand some of these things, and one reason I know I understand them is because it works. See, it won't work if you don't understand it. One reason you can tell when somebody understands it, it's because they're getting the results. If you don't understand electricity, it's not going to work for you. Somebody had to understand it before they could put it to work and harness its power. Because that same power that'll bless you can kill you if you don't understand it. It won't work for you. And the power of God will not work for you unless you understand it. So some of these things I understand, and I keep trying to get people to understand it because I see people not receiving. And I know why most of the time. It's because they don't understand it. Faith comes by hearing. I mean, there can be other hindrances, but the biggest hindrance is a lack of understanding. That's what Jesus said. This people's heart is waxed gross. Their ears are dull of hearing. Their eyes, they've closed, but at any time, if they would see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and be converted. I'd heal them. You've got to understand it. And so, people say, well, lay hands on the sick and they'll recover, and healing always begins. And that's good. You hear that. If you don't know, that sounds good. But I compare with Jesus. Jesus is my supreme example. And in his own hometown, he couldn't do a mighty work. One translation says he's tried and couldn't do a mighty work. And that's Jesus. He laid hands on a few sick folk and healed them. Few means not many. And sick there must mean they didn't have much wrong, because he couldn't do a mighty work. And it says he couldn't do a mighty work. Mark chapter 6, verse 5. And the next verse says he went about teaching. He marveled at their unbelief. And the unbelief wasn't just the individual. The unbelief was the atmosphere. Because this is where they tried to run him off the cliff of the, off the cliff. They tried to kill him. Mark 6 and Luke 4 are the same experience. If you read both of those places, you get a better picture of what's happening. He's in his own hometown. They're not receiving him. And that's hindering the anointing. The atmosphere is hindering his flow, the anointing. And so he laid hands on the sick and couldn't do a mighty work. Well, if that's true of Jesus, that's going to be true of Mark 16, verse 20. These signs shall follow them that believe. Verses 18, 19, and 20. So if one person does get healed, that verse is true, because a believer laid hands on the sick and they got healed. And believers are doing that. Believers are laying hands on the sick and they're getting healed. Is that true? Are all getting healed? Of course not. Did everybody get healed under Jesus' ministry? No, they didn't. Not everybody. There at the Pool of Bethesda, only one got healed. And there's a multitude, great multitude, of impotent folk. Now, where they believed him, you contrast Mark chapter 6 with Luke chapter 6. And I'm going to go a different direction in just a moment as I follow the leading of the Spirit. If he leads to continue to go this direction, I'll do that. But as I'm following the leading of the Spirit, I have something else I want to say. But just going with this flow, Aretta asked a good question. Contrast Mark chapter 6 with Luke chapter 6. In Mark chapter 6, he couldn't do a mighty work. He laid hands on a few sick folk and healed them, and he marveled at their unbelief and went about teaching. But in Luke chapter 6, it says they came to hear him and to be healed. And as many as touched him, it says they sought to touch him. I wonder why they sought to touch him. Could it possibly be something that he said in his teaching? They sought to touch him. Could that possibly be because of something they heard him say? It says they came to hear him and to be healed. That's verse 17. And then verse 19, the whole multitude sought to touch him. Now, why did they seek to touch him? Could it possibly be because of something they heard him say? Now, in Mark 6, he's teaching there also. He's in the synagogue teaching. And he must have, in his teaching, mentioned the miracles of Capernaum. Now, why is he mentioning Capernaum? Because he wants to brag a little bit on who he is and his anointing. He got the book of Isaiah and found the place where it was written in Isaiah. And he read and said, "The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me to preach." Then he closed the book. That's in Luke 4. But see, it's the same experience. Luke 4 and Mark 6 are the same experience. To get the best picture of what happened there that day when he's teaching in the synagogue, read both of those places. So there he is. He found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me to preach." Now, is he bragging? I'm anointed. Oh, you're just talking about yourself. Well, they got mad at him because they thought he was talking big talk. It didn't work. I tell you, it's hard to get somebody healed who's criticizing. It just is. It just is. And I backed off for a long time, and I got into trouble. I opened the door, and sickness came on me, and I wasn't receiving my healing. I went to the Lord with 3 days of fasting and prayer. And the third day, the Spirit of God told me, you didn't do what I told you to do. Don't you remember I said to tell it? Well, I said, Lord, I didn't want to tell it. They're criticizing me. Well, what are you going to do then? Are you going to obey or stay sick? You open the door to the devil and sickness is there, and you want the blessing of God, you better obey. Somebody say amen. That's how this works. That's how this works. So I said, Lord, forgive me. I repent. Now, I'd gone maybe a few years in his permissive will of God. Well, in that area, I'm not even in his will. And I had blessings in many areas of my ministry. I just didn't talk much about the healing anointing. I'd pray for the sick because believers do that. And I'd have gifts of the Spirit operate. I'd see people healed, but not because of the healing anointings per se. I didn't talk about it. I just pray for people and gifts of the Spirit would operate and the faith of the Word would produce results. Imogene's been with me in nearly my entire ministry. And she'd go, if I was within 2 hours of home, she'd drive to where I was. So she's seen quite a bit. So I could have her stand up and tell some stories. We'd have miracles, but it wasn't because I talked about the healing anointing, because I backed off. And so it'd been maybe 3 years. And I said, Lord, I repent, forgive me. Next service that I'm going to preach is this coming Sunday night. That'll be my message. I'll preach on it. And so that Sunday night came up and I talked about the anointing, special anointings. Special anointings. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me. Now, that's what Jesus said, but Jesus said, as my Father sent me, I'm sending you. That's what he said in John 20. Did he say that or not? As my Father hath sent me, even I'm sending you. If you've got an anointing, you'll need to tell people about it to give them the opportunity to believe it. And they'll criticize you because Jesus said they would. Jesus said, if they hated me, they'll hate you. And I can testify that's the truth. But he also said, if they love me, they'll love you. And I can testify that's the truth. And that's why it's good to get to the place where you're not moved by the cheers or the jeers. One deliverance that Paul spoke of, I think, is Acts chapter 26, where Jesus Christ appeared to him, and Paul was recounting that. And he said, Jesus Christ said, I'm going to deliver you from the people. Oh, what a tremendous deliverance. People say, I'm in a deliverance ministry. Well, get in that one then. Get delivered from the people. Because there's going to be some that are for you and going to be some that are against you. But you can't be moved either way. You can't be moved by the praise of men, and you can't be moved by the criticism of men. You can't preach because they like you. You can't preach because they hate you. You've got to just obey God. Amen. And that's good to be around people that like you, and you'll have more results. Jesus had more results. You think about Luke chapter 5. He's teaching, and they came from every quarter. Now, some say he's teaching in a house because it's the roof that the man came down through. But it's a lot of people. It could have been a house, but it's a big one because there's a lot of people there. And Pharisees and the doctors of the law and the scribes and the religious people. Luke chapter 5, it says the power of the Lord was present to heal them. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. Now, here's another place where he did not heal them all. Even though the power was present and he was teaching. I think I've been to that church. Well, why then? The power of the Lord was present to heal them, but none of them got healed. A man that came down through the roof got healed. But that's certainly not them. That would just be him. Is that right? It doesn't say the power was present to heal him. It said the power was present to heal them. And none of them got healed, just him. They came down through the roof. And when Jesus spoke, and he did that on purpose, man, thy sins be forgiven thee. He did that on purpose just to stir up the religious devils in the place. He did that on purpose. The Father led him to do that. He said, it's the Father in me, he doeth the works. The Father led him to do that. Now, I don't know if on the inside he said, Father, I'd rather not say that. They won't like it. But I know I've been there. I've said that in my heart. I've actually said this, Lord, you're going to get me into trouble because they won't like that. And there's been some times where I didn't. And that doesn't go over good. Well, man, thy sins be forgiven thee. And they begin to criticize him. This man speaks blasphemes. Who can forgive sins but God? Well, he knew what they were thinking. He could tell. So he responded, even though they didn't say it right out loud. Now, to him, it might have been just as clear as if they had said it out loud. But he responded. And he says, let me ask you a question. Which is easier? To say your sins are forgiven or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? And so he did something to prove, demonstrate. When God demonstrates, it ought to close the mouth of the skeptic. It ought to. It doesn't always, but it should. They'll go away like they did Jesus. So, well, sure, he did that, but he did it by the power of Satan. Didn't they say that about Jesus? Oh, yeah, he did that, but he did it by the power of Satan. Is that what they said about him? So the atmosphere will affect you. It did in Luke 5. He couldn't do a mighty work in Mark 6. And the power was present both places. Amen. That's right. And in Luke 5, the man that he did heal, he said, go home. I think part of that is get out of here. They'll talk you out of it. You'll lose your healing if you stick around here. Take up your bed and go home. Get out of this house. Go home. So the power was present. Now, I said earlier, and this is the scripture that I came to, it's hard to get somebody who's criticized and healed. And the reason the power of the Lord was present to heal, but they didn't get healed, is because they're critical. I just would rather get away from that. If God's using somebody, I'm for them. I may not agree with everything they... You know, nobody's doctrine is perfect. But God's using him. I'm for him. I'm for him. If God's using him, I'm for him. Amen. Just side in with what God's doing. God's doing that. Well, I believe I'd do it differently. Well, side in with what God's doing. Well, I don't know if I'd agree with that. Well, do you see any signs, wonders, and mighty deeds and miracles? He's not doing that on his own. Well, I just believe the devil's doing that. That's what they said about Jesus. I'm going to side in with him. I just would rather have mercy. I'm going to side in with mercy. Can somebody say amen? Amen. I'm just going to side in with mercy. But I was contrasting Mark 6 with Luke 6. In Mark 6, he's teaching. In Luke 4, same experience, he's teaching. And he said, the Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me. You've got to tell it. They didn't believe it, but you still have to tell it. And then he must have told some experiences about Capernaum. Now, why is he doing that? He's doing that to encourage them to expect the same thing. Amen. What I did in Capernaum, I can do right here. Let me tell you about what happened in Capernaum. But the scornful, the critic... The skeptic will say, well, he's just talking about himself. Who does he think he is? Well, we know him. He's Mary and Joseph's son. And a prophet is not without honor, save in his own country. And Jesus couldn't do a mighty work because of their unbelief. What is unbelief? Well, in that case, it's because they didn't accept it. So he's got the same teaching, he's got the same anointing, and he's teaching the same message. I believe, is in Luke 6. So over in Luke 6, he's teaching. What's he see? He might have talked about Capernaum. He might have quoted Luke 4. I mean, what he did in Luke 4, the same scripture out of Isaiah. He might have quoted that, the same as he did in Luke 4:18. He might have quoted the same scripture out of Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me. Let me tell you about some works of God we had in Capernaum. And in Luke 6, they believed it. And they sought to touch him. They sought to touch him. Verse 19, the whole multitude sought to touch him. Because there went virtue or power or the anointing out of him. Now the healing anointing is different from the anointing to heal. Gifts of the Spirit can operate as the Spirit wills. And if the Spirit wills, they don't have to believe anything. It can operate when there's unbelief. It can operate when there's no teaching or preaching at all. In John chapter 5, he didn't teach, he didn't preach, but Jesus healed one man. That was a gift of the Spirit. And when they asked him about it, in John 5:19, he said, the Son can do nothing of himself, meaning of this nature. I didn't do this on my own. I saw the Father do this. That man didn't even know who I was. The man didn't even know who he was. He conveyed himself away. A multitude was in that place, and he only healed one. He didn't touch other people and minister to them and pray for them and share scripture with them. If the Father had led him to do it, he would have. Be led by the Spirit of God. You'll get more results that way. And so he left. He conveyed himself away, John 5 says. And the man didn't even know who he was. So the gifts of the Spirit can operate when you haven't heard any teaching, as the Father wills, as the Spirit wills. 1 Corinthians 12 teaches that they operate as the Spirit wills. Well, the anointing is given to a minister as the Spirit wills, but even after you have it, it operates as the Spirit wills. Because Jesus had all of the anointing available under the old covenant, and he said the Son can do nothing of himself. So he couldn't do it just on his own. Are you hearing me? And so, the anointing to heal can involve the gifts of the Spirit, or people believe in the Word. Lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. Tell people that, and if they believe that, and when they believe that, when you lay hands on them, they can recover. The anointing to heal can go from you into them because they're believing that Scripture. God will respond to Scripture. You don't have to have a call of God on your life. Just believe that Scripture. Share it with other people. Get them to believe it too. Lay hands on them. The Bible says lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. I've got hands. And you have been diagnosed with sickness. And Jesus is the healer. The Bible says lay hands on the sick. I've got hands. And the Bible says they'll recover. Do you believe that? If they say, yes, I believe that, you lay hands on them, watch them recover. The anointing can go from you into them, and that's an anointing to heal by the Word. The Word of God will produce it, and every believer can do that, and these signs shall follow them that believe. That's the anointing to heal that comes through the Word. They believe you don't have a special, you don't need a special anointing to do that. I said you don't need a special anointing to do that. You don't need a special anointing to do that. Get people to believe the Bible, and the Word of God will do the work. I've got hands. You've been diagnosed as sick. Jesus said that they would recover. These signs. Jesus said this. These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name, lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. Get them to believe that, and they'll recover. That's the anointing to heal. That's not the healing anointing. The healing anointing is what God has put inside a minister that comes out when the person touches by faith. The woman that had the issue of blood heard about that. In Luke 6, they heard about that, and they sought to touch him because when they did, that power went out of him. In Mark chapter 5, the woman that had the issue of blood heard about it. And she said, I'm going to get to him. I'm going to touch him. If I just touch his clothes, I'll be made whole. And she touched him. And Jesus said, who touched me? And the disciples said, Master, the multitude. Everybody say multitude. You suppose any of those others were sick? I mean, in a multitude, how far would you have to look before you find a sick person? In a multitude, how far would you have to look before you find a sick person? The multitude thronged thee, and not a one of them is getting healed. Even though they're thronging him. I want to get results. Bless God, I want to get results. I think about Matthew 9, two blind men are following him. They must have heard something. They're following him. They're crying and saying, Thou Son of David, have mercy on us. They must have heard something because they're calling him the Son of David. They must have heard something about the Messiah. When he comes, he'll have healing in his wings. And they're following him, crying and saying, and yet Jesus doesn't turn around one time. I've been there. I want to get results just like Jesus wants to get results. You don't always play up to somebody's feelings and emotions. The Syrophoenician woman, Jesus could have offended her. It's not right to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. She could have gone away mad. I've seen people go away mad. When I wanted them well, I wanted them to receive, but I gave them something that would challenge them. That's what Jesus did. It's hard to get somebody healed who's offended. And that woman could have gotten offended. It's not right to take the children's bread. This is Matthew 15. Also Mark 7. It's not right to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. And she could have gotten offended and left right there. Is that true or not? She could have gone home and told her friends and her family and her neighbors and everybody. I went to Jesus just like you said I should. And I told him about my daughter just like you said I should. And he told me it wasn't right to heal my daughter, to deliver her from the devil, because she's grievously tormented of the devil. He said it wasn't right. And that would have been correct. She could have told the truth. He said it wasn't right, and that would have been correct, but she would have missed the point. He wants her to approach him differently. Don't be offended. If I can get you past being offended, you're in a better position. And she said, truth, Lord. But even the dogs under the master's table can have the crumbs that fall from the table. And in Mark chapter 7, Jesus said, because you said this. I wish people would hear that. I said again and again and again. God is watching what you do and listening to what you say. And some things are never going to happen until you do the right thing and you say the right thing. I don't care what it is and how merciful God is. Some things will never happen until you do the right thing, until you say the right thing. Because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And this is the way he was then. He's still that way tonight. Amen. Amen. For this saying, go thy way, the devil is gone out of thy daughter. He's given her an opportunity. Some might say he's given her a challenge or even a test. What kind of stuff are you made of? Let's see how you act now. Let's see what you say now. And that will solely determine what you receive. And for this saying, oh, I wish people would hear me. You've got to stay with contrition and humility and perseverance and determination. I'm not going to be a critical person. I'm not going to be a scornful person. And I'm not going to get offended. Bless God forever. I know where the answer is, and I'm staying with the answer. On one occasion, Jesus asked his disciples, are you going to leave me too? And they said, we don't have anywhere else to go. You've got the answer. I tell you, this is the answer. This is the answer. This is the answer. And when God has anointed a minister, I can receive from that anointing because I receive him as sent by Jesus Christ. And I'll be blessed. If you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you'll receive what he has. If you receive a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, you'll receive what he has. Paul said, for this cause many are sick. And the reason was because they weren't rightly discerning the Lord's body. The Lord's body is more than just the one on the cross and on the tree. The Lord's body is the body of Christ in the midst of you and me. And we're members of that body, members in particular. If God's called one, I want to recognize the anointing and the gift and the call. Amen. There's more to this than just, well, I'm going to believe His word. Can somebody say amen? Oh, my. I got into some preaching. And this is good whether you know it or not. In Mark chapter 5, that woman touched Him and drew something out, even though the multitude was thronging Him. He said, there's an anointing that's left me. He knew in Him. He knew. I don't know why it works sometimes the way it does. I'm the same person. Now, if I would prepare, these things won't operate if you live a carnal life. Romans chapter 12, Paul said, he that ministereth, let him wait on his ministry. That is, stay prepared. Stay prepared. Stay ready. But I don't know why it is sometimes. You're in a healing line or a prayer line. You lay hands on this person. Nothing happens. You lay hands on the next person. And it seems like you caught a live wire. After the service, they'll come up and just want to shake hands with you. Brother Tony, I just wanted to tell you goodbye before I left. And I remember one time I was crouched down getting some wires. I'm unpacking my equipment and unhooking some wires that were down on the floor. And I raised up and took the lady's hand. When I took her hand, she fell. Another lady came back to tell me that she had just gone to the restroom. She didn't really look for it and tend to, but she said, I had a goiter the size of a hen egg in my abdomen area, and it's gone. I didn't even pray for that. I just touched her. I just touched her. Oh, he's bragging now. I'm doing what Jesus told me to do. It's the anointing that destroys the yoke, and God's anointed people. God's anointed His people. God's anointed His people. God's anointed His church. God's anointed His body. And when we rise up and we say Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and as His Father sent Him, He sent us, and He is the same, and He's in His people, He's in His body, and the anointing of the Holy Ghost is in the body of Christ, and that's us today on this earth. And the anointing destroys the yoke. You get people to believe that. And you'll see tumors disappear when they just didn't even feel it and they just went to the restroom after the service and realized that thing's gone. I think she said it was a goose egg. Size of a goose egg. Is a tumor, that right? Not a goiter. I said goiter, but it's a tumor. A tumor the size of a goose egg. There just below her abdomen area. And she just went to the restroom. And she said, I wanted to come tell you. I don't know why it flows sometimes the way it does. But I know it's the anointing. And the multitude thronged thee. But he knew in himself virtue had gone out of him. And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. The woman fearing and trembling because she's not even supposed to be here. Unclean, unclean, unclean. She's got an issue of blood and Levitical law would prohibit her from even being here. So she's done something wrong. And so she's fearing and trembling. I believe she wanted to touch his clothes and just sort of disappear and not be found out. But he called her out and she fearing and trembling fell down before him and told him all the truth. And Jesus said, you just don't need to have any fear. Just to have peace. Go in peace. You don't need to have any fear. Nothing's going to happen to you. Jairus was right there. He could have ordered her to be stoned. The ruler of the synagogue was right there. But Jesus said, your faith. Others are touching me. And I don't know what they're thinking or what they're believing. You know, Scripture doesn't tell us about the other people. I don't know what they were thinking, what they were believing. But the Bible does tell us that her faith made her whole. So her touch was different from their touch. Her touch was different. And her touch drew it out. And Jesus knew the virtue or the power or the anointing had gone out. And that's the healing anointing. Now, I quote this scripture. And sometimes people don't put it together. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with two things. the Holy Ghost, and power. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me. The Holy Ghost, the anointing, the gifts of the Spirit, the anointing to preach. But what's that word power? That's the healing anointing. That's different from the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Now, it's all the Holy Ghost, but did you notice it's in there differentiated? How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with, now two things are said, the Holy Ghost and power. Well, I have the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Well, Jesus had that, but he also had something else that not everybody has. Well, I've got the anointing in me. Every Christian does. Every Christian does. That's wonderful, but that's not this. That's not this. There's a difference anyway between the Spirit within and the Spirit upon. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. There's a difference between the Spirit within and the Spirit upon. I've got the anointing within. Well, do you have this, the anointing upon? And then that's not even the power that this is talking about. The healing anointing is the power that's released by the faith of the person that when they hear about it, they want to touch you. They want to be touched or they want to touch. And when that touch occurs, there's a transfer that flows. I said, when that touch occurs, there's a transfer that flows. When it's the touch of faith that's drawing it out, not waiting for God to do it, but drawing it out. And then you maintain it by faith. And that's another message. That's another week of messages. Because you can walk out the door, and if you don't maintain it by faith, you can lose it before you get out of the parking lot. You maintain it by faith. I've got the anointing in me, and it's doing a work. The anointing has been administered to me, and it's in me now doing a work. And you might need to stand your ground for some hours and some days and some weeks. That man that I talked about in Lodi, California, went 3 months before he saw any change, and then another 3 months before it was totally disappeared. The healing anointing is in me, and I believe it's in me doing a work. Can somebody say amen? The healing anointing is different from the anointing to heal.